Okay, Mr. Swan, I want to begin if you will tell us your name, how old you are, and where you were born.
My name is Melvin Chester Swan, Jr. I go by Mel. I'm 72 years old, and I was born in Alabama City, Alabama.
I'll figure out the math, what that translates to.
Yeah.
What years did you first come to Price as a teacher and then an administrator?
I first came to Price School in 1960, in January of 1960, mid-year. And for the remainder of that year, I taught the sixth grade. And then the following year, I was a substitute that year for the remainder of the year. Then the following year, I was hired as a full-time teacher, and I taught science, earth science, and life science at J.C. Price. I taught there for 6 years, and I was made assistant principal. I served as assistant principal for 3 years. After the retirement of Mr. Peeler.
So this would have been, 1966 to 69, you were assistant principal?
I can give you all of that.
And then when Mr. Peeler retired in 1969,
right,
you took over?
I was assistant principal 69 to 71.
Oh, okay, sorry, I was
kidding. Principal 69 yeah. to 71. I was assistant principal from 66 to 69.
Okay.
And I taught from 60 to 66. Mm-hmm. I taught earth science. I was department chair. I also was assistant football coach, head basketball coach, and baseball coach. from 58 to 59, I taught 1 year in Hertford County before coming to Greensboro. Mm-hmm.
So that was your entree to North Carolina?
That was my entree to North Carolina, and and went to North Carolina, C.S. Brown High School.
Mm-hmm. Was that, want to talk about some of the, later about the various activities that went on at Price, but mm-hmm. was that at all unusual for a teacher as yourself to be wearing so many hats as chair, as teaching multiple subjects, as coaching three different teams?
People did what they were asked to do or what they liked to do, and not too unusual. I was not a department chair initially, but as time went on, I, with seniority and so forth, I became
sure.
department chair.
Mm-hmm.
And I played sports, and so the coaching was a pleasure to me. My friend and co-worker was the head coach, so I assisted him in football, and then I coached basketball and baseball. So it was just part of the duty there and working with the young people in that community.
Mm-hmm. Just to continue your biography before we talk more about your years at Price, after you left Price, what did you do after that?
Well, after I left Price, I was asked to come to the central office, and I served as director of student affairs, the first director of student affairs. This was the year, well, prior to my last year at Price, the system desegregated mm-hmm. the staff. We had had an all African-American staff at Price School, and they the board decided to integrate staff, and during that time we received about five or six white teachers. And then the next year the student body
in 1971 then the
right
student, okay.
That was the year that they closed Price as a junior high school and it became an elementary school. Now Price School had an elementary department and a junior high department. And at one time, when I first came to Price, we had fourth through ninth grade. And then later, the fourth grade was moved to David D. Jones. And I was told that prior to my coming, many years earlier, Price School had grades 1 through 9.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, at that time, they didn't have kindergarten. And so right. It was first grade through ninth grade. But as David D. Jones, an elementary school, which is a stone's throw from Price School, was built, then gradually various grades were moved to that school.
We had noticed that, and we're curious about that. I'm glad you could clear mm-hmm. that up, because we noticed when the third grade seemed to actually come and go
right.
in earlier years, mm-hmm. and then obviously the earlier grades got lopped off. And we were
That's
just curious
right.
when and why that happened. So it was because the Jones School opened.
That is correct. And then the fourth grade went, and so during my tenure there, there was grade 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9.
Mm-hmm. And was the ninth grade in addition, do you know, later? Because we thought it only went up to 8.
No, the ninth grade was there. And
from the very beginning?
See, during that time, ninth grade was a part of the junior high schools. And
yeah.
most of the models of the other junior high schools in the city were grades 7 through 9. Some years later, it was a decision to move the ninth grades to high school.
And make it 6 through 8.
And make the sixth grade and change the model from junior high to middle school.
Mm-hmm.
And so those grades were 6, 7, and 8, which meant that elementary was kindergarten through fifth grade.
So from its opening, Price had a ninth grade?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I believe.
Okay.
I believe it. Yeah, in fact, I'm sure it did, because the ninth grade was not in the high school until later.
Okay. So obviously they would have had
right.
it before they could go to Dudley. They had to go to ninth grade
right.
at Price. So back, you were saying you were at the central office in 1971, and then from there?
From the central office, I have to go back and review some of this, because I can give you those. I was director of student affairs from 71 to 75. And my responsibility was to see that students got a fair shake in their integrated setting. In other words, there were students at School A that were moved to School B. And my responsibility encompassed all of the student activities except athletics, cheerleading, clubs, all of those kinds of activities. And we formed what we call student affairs committees at each element, at each junior high school and at each high school. My responsibility was primarily at junior high and high school level.
Uh-huh.
And I held that role as director of student affairs from 71 to 75. And in 75, I was made assistant principal for pupil personnel services. And pupil personnel services involved guidance, school social work, some 13 programs in exceptional children, and also school nursing and psychology. And I held that responsibility as assistant for pupil personnel services until 1979. And in 79, I was made assistant superintendent for professional support services. What they did at that time was to combine pupil personnel services and instructional services together, and they called it professional support services. So I had all of the central office staff with the exception of personnel and finance and those other ancillary areas. So all of the instructional directors, all of the pupil personnel directors, I was responsible for.
Mm-hmm. That's an enormous responsibility.
Yeah, it was. But I had good people working in those areas, and it worked out quite well. The real, I guess, problem or difficulty initially was those two areas were sort of competing for funds prior to their coming together as one group. Mm-hmm. And so we had to sort of change the mindset that we're all one now. Of course, we did that. I took the whole staff down to Quail Roost, which is the conference center for UNC Chapel Hill. And we spent a weekend down there with some facilitators, getting us into us instead of us, we kind of mode. And it worked quite well.
And then after 1979?
After 79, I was made assistant superintendent for elementary schools and community services. I had 32 elementary schools I was responsible for, and all the community service activities that were involved in the school system came through my office. And I served in that capacity the professional support services was from 79 to 82. That was 3 years. Mm-hmm. And then from 1982 to 1990, which was 8 years, I served as assistant for elementary schools and community services.
Mm-hmm. Did you finally retire and take a rest?
Not yet. Then in 1990, I was made associate superintendent for administration and management. Now, and that was until 1993. Now, administration and management involved all of the areas of service areas of the school system, with the exception of personnel and finance. It involved the school cafeteria programs. It involved transportation, print shop, construction, all of the areas other than personnel and finance. Uh-huh. And I had two directors. One was for administration and the other one was for management. And we served in that capacity for 2 years.
So it sounds like the superintendent and or the school board was sending you around to fix a lot of problems. You'd get one department running well, so they'd bump you up and make you have you go fix another one.
right. And then in 1973 we had consolidation. Mm-hmm. And well, it's 1972 actually. The new board was elected, and I was named director of transition. And my responsibility was to lead and to set up the reorganization for the consolidated school system. This involved Greensboro, Guilford County, and High Point school systems coming together as the Guilford County schools.
Was that a pretty with the Swan decision? Mm-hmm. No relation, but Charlotte Mecklenburg consolidated pretty early. But was Greensboro one of the earliest places in North Carolina where consolidation occurred?
One of the early ones, and it was decided I think Greensboro and High Point were sort of willing. I think Guilford County was a little reluctant to join that, but a bill was introduced in the legislature that set up the merger, and so it happened. Mm-hmm. And my responsibility was I had two responsibilities. I was still working as associate superintendent for administration and management in the Greensboro schools, because the superintendent at that time, Pete Everhart, asked me to kind of stay on because we want to finish together and so forth. Yet I had another office downtown that worked out of that office with the new board. And we were responsible for the organizational charts or the new organization for the school system. Of course, the board would have to approve of it. I had to set up a skeleton administrative group. In other words, the assistant superintendents and the other systems, I had to bring them in and give them various assignments in terms of the organization for the new school district. We had to recodify all of the administrative regulations, because you had three sets of administrative regulations, and we had to bring that into one. Mm-hmm. We found out in looking at that some school systems included in the administrative and board policies things that were school law, and so we could eliminate those because they were in another document as school law and didn't have to be in those. So we had something like 600 or more policies and regulations, and we got that down to less than 100.
Wow, bureaucrat who manages to eliminate rules and not make more, that's got to be an exception. I just want to make sure I get the date right. You said 1972.
I'm sorry.
Did you mean 1992?
That was...
when consolidation
happened? 1993. That was in 1993.
Three, the consolidation.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
right.
93.
Still pretty early, right? Because I believe Durham was late 90s and other districts
that
were later.
True. So. That is true. Okay. We were one of the earliest systems.
Okay.
And, it was in 1992, because in 93, that's when the consolidation actually took place.
But the decision had been made in 92.
The decision was made in 92, and all the organizational kind of things were being done in 92. Mm-hmm. And that's when I was working back and forth between Greensboro and the new system. Mm-hmm. And attending two board meetings a month, because the new board operated just like a board. They just didn't take over the system until the next year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So perhaps not the only motivation for consolidation, but was that a response to white flight out in the county schools?
That was some of it. The other thing was it was felt that economics played a part in it, in that instead of each school system, ordering materials and so forth, that we could consolidate that and there were so many things that we could consolidate. For instance, we downsized in a sense because we had three personnel departments, we had three of everything, and mm-hmm. we had to bring that down to one and reassign some people. Retirements helped in some instances, but it was a tedious task because some people did not get the positions that they had previously. But we had to move through that.
I guess I want to lose that train of thought, backing up a bit to 1970-71 when desegregation occurred. Mm-hmm. Of course, you were, you're right in the thick of it. You've gone from Price to the central office. What effect do you think desegregation had on Price School, on students, on faculty? Both good and bad. Were there new opportunities afforded to them, getting to go to so-called better schools? And what was lost in the process?
Well, what happened was all of the junior high school teachers were transferred to other junior high schools. So that was pretty much, and it was more of a junior high school than it was an elementary school.
Before 1970.
Before that time. Okay. So the only thing that was left were the elementary grades, mm-hmm. and then consequently, some of the elementary teachers had an opportunity to go other places, and when the school system, when that school was reorganized, it was reorganized. I think initially, I'm not sure if I have my facts straight. I think it was a magnet school at that time. So that meant that some people had an opportunity to transfer out. And so there were very few people that were left in that school that were there previously. Maybe one or two or whatever.
Mm-hmm. And what would you, how would you take that as a, is that a detriment? Was that a loss in your?
It wasn't a loss because what we tried to do is to leave documents, to leave information about the history of the school and all of the previous kinds of things. I met with the principal that succeeded me, talked with her and sort of laid the foundation.
Was she a white principal? Or?
Yes.
And so presumably she obviously wasn't from Warnersville, so she wasn't a part of the community as previous.
Not. Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So do you think, did the Price School maintain its community character that it had before, after 1971?
To a certain extent. I think Price School always symbolized a place in that community. But see, at the same time, some other things were happening. Redevelopment took place. Mm-hmm. And when redevelopment took place, many of the people that were so-called natives of Warnersville were scattered out in other communities, and some of those people never really got back to the Warnersville community. They landed in other communities and just stayed there while the redevelopment was taking place. So in a sense, I guess the whole dynamics of that community changed to a certain extent.
And really the two are coincidental, occurring at the same time.
That is correct, okay. Yes.
What happened to the quality of the education that these, students were able to get, if not at Price any longer? Do you think, was that a benefit? Did they get access to better education?
I'm not sure
going
that
someplace
the education
else?
Was better, but it was, I think we tried to make sure that the quality, was maintained, but I'm not sure it was any better than it was before. Mm-hmm. I do think that perhaps prior to desegregation, there was a maybe more of a nurturing environment that took place at Price Schools. The teachers took more than just a surface interest in their students. They knew the families. They visited the homes. They had taught brothers and sisters, all of those kinds of things, which I think helped to bond the students and the faculty together. And so I think that was lost because many of those people were in other environments later.
Either teachers who weren't part of the Warnersville community now teaching there, or those teachers
were
out
somewhere else.
Now. Okay.
Yeah, yes.
And you're right in the thick of that as principal at Price when this is happening. Do you recall what that process was like? What did the Price parents, what did the Price teachers think about the prospects of desegregation?
Well, it was traumatic to some certain extent. We had closed school. The last day of the students had taken place. And that weekend, in other words, that last day was on that Friday. Well, that Saturday, I was at home with my family, and we were eating and watching the news on television. And that's when it was announced that the desegregation plan had been approved, and then they ran down some of the schools and the changes and so forth. Well, when I got back to school on Monday, my teachers were on edge, and they thought that I had known that all of this was going to take place. Because, see, we had faculty meeting. See, we had work days after school closed, and we had faculty meeting. And so I told them, I said, I am as shocked about this as you are, and I know as much about it as you do. I said, but I am leaving right now. We will have the meeting in the next couple of hours when I get back, but I am going down to the central office, and I'm going to talk with the superintendent to find out what's going on. So I did. I went down, and the superintendent He must have known that I was very anxious because I talked with the secretary and she went in to see him and he saw me immediately. Well, he was more concerned seemingly about me, you know. Don't worry, you're going to have a principalship. And I said, that's not my concern right now. My concern is I've got 35 or 40 people back there wondering what's going to happen to them. And I've got to tell them something. And I want to tell them the facts as they are. And so we talked about it. And then I went back to the staff and called the staff meeting and told them what I knew about the situation. And it was very traumatic because we had been together as a staff through a lot of things, and it was almost like a family at Price School. And to show you the amount of cohesion that we had is, in as soon as we could in 71, that's when we formed the organization, the Peeler Swan J.C. Price School family, and started meeting as a group because we did not want to lose that contact that we had with each other. And we met on a regular basis, at least twice a year, in the summer and around Christmas time, just to maintain the fellowship and to find out what each other was doing.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a bond. There was a bond between the staff, and there was a bond between the staff and the students and the home.
Mm-hmm. So were the were most of the Price teachers able to keep their jobs? Did they?
Oh yeah,
keep
no one. No one lost their job.
Were they demoted? Did they?
No, no one was demoted. No one lost their job. Everyone was. For instance, I did not have to take the job as student affairs director. The superintendent indicated, in fact, he even indicated the school that he would send me to because it was coming up a retirement. And he told me that I'd be sent to that school and there would be no problem and so forth. And then about a few weeks later, I got called to the central office and they received a federal grant. And they felt that they needed someone in the area of student activities to pull that piece together. And they made the proposal to me, and I accepted it. And that's how I got to the central office.
You think, did Price teachers fare about as well as, say, Gillespie or Lincoln teachers did, or better? And if so, was it because of your influence and the connection you had to the superintendent that you could make sure your staff was taken care of?
Well, that was my indication. When I first went down, that morning I told you I went down, that was my concern then, that my teachers would be taken care of and they would be dealt with fairly in terms of their placements and so forth. And I was promised that this would take place, and it did, you know.
And you think, was the Gillespie principal doing the same thing? Was the Lincoln principal doing the same thing?
I think so. I think what they tried to do was to look at the vacancies. You see, you also had students that were impacting other schools, so which meant that these school enrollments were a larger. So they needed these teachers at other schools to take care of the bulge in enrollment, and it was just a matter of where they were actually going. And some, I think, they called down and said, "We have vacancies here, here, and here. You know, and where would you like to be considered?"
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they would have to talk with the principal too, because you know you don't want to assign somebody and the principal not know about it. So there was a process that took place after that. And I think there was an effort, let's say, to see that all teachers were treated fairly.
Mm-hmm. That's, you know, that's when the process is a done deal, as it were, backing up maybe a year plus.
Mm-hmm.
How would you gauge the attitude, as best you could tell, of course, then, from Price faculty, from Price parents, about the prospects for desegregation? Were they in favor of it? Were they skeptical about it?
I think they were in favor of integration, and I think they knew that there would be some areas where they would have to make some sacrifices. I'm not sure that the parents or the teachers, I mean the parents or the students felt that way, but I think the teachers felt that way.
Why do you suppose? Why were they in favor of it?
But I think, because, let's face it, there were things that other schools had through not only central office, but through their PTA groups and so forth that they could afford to do. For instance, textbooks, auxiliary and ancillary materials and so forth. We were fortunate at Price because we had a principal, A.H. Peeler, who was, I think, far ahead of his time.
Sure.
He sought other means. For instance, we were one of 500 schools in the nation that the 3M company furnished overhead projectors, and that was the state of the art at that
sure.
time.
Mm-hmm.
In every classroom, we had opaque projectors. We had other kind of audio-visual material, duplicating machines, and so forth and so on. So Mr. Peeler was also on the cutting edge of audio-visual aids. Price School was one of the first schools to have an operating FM radio station where students were able to hone their skills as radio personalities and so forth. And there were so many things. There was a utilization of the staff. For instance, our elementary teachers were given time to work with junior high school students in reading. In other words, we developed a developmental reading program. Hmm. And these students, the elementary teachers worked with them during this time. Some elementary youngsters were able to take French. We had a French teacher that was there for the junior high, but we were able to, through unique scheduling, to make sure that some youngsters had a foreign language experience.
Hmm.
The guidance counselor was there because of the junior high school. There were no elementary counselors during that time, but she counseled all students, even elementary students. So there were some great benefits and unique opportunities because of a principal that had a lot of insight and a lot of creativity.
And doing things that the district just wasn't doing or the schools
right,
weren't doing.
That is correct.
Huh.
That is correct. And, of course, he had the latitude to do that as principal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You think, I don't know, his part was some of it latitude in the relative kind of neglect, the fact that Price was a black school, that the district paid less attention to it. And all the bad things that
yeah.
went with that, but also
yeah.
the leeway that you all had to forge your own path.
Well, I think that had been over the years. It wasn't a recent phenomenon. This is something that happened over a period of time
since he got there in the 30s.
For instance, years ago, textbooks from the other schools we got, or the rebound textbooks, or things of that type, you know. But things begin to get better because, as I said, Mr. Peeler was on the cutting edge. He was a very crafty person, and he could get more things from central office than most because of the way he dealt with people.
And did you pick up some of those skills as his assistant
bit.
Principal?
I learned quite a bit from him,
yeah.
quite a bit. He was my mentor. I had two people really that sort of helped me along and helped me forge my administrative skills. Mr. Peeler, who gave me the first opportunity to be involved in administration, and I learned by just watching and listening to him. And then I had a professor at UNC Chapel Hill when I was doing my graduate work, Lester Ball, who sort of took me under his wing, and he was very helpful.
You know. Mm-hmm.
But Mr. Peeler was a man for all seasons, and he was just phenomenal. He was the kind of man you would go down. For instance, he asked me to take the intramural program in the afternoon after school. We were granted the opportunity to have an intramural program for those students that were not athletes that could have various kinds of physical activities. And so I went to him and said, "Mr. Peeler, I would like to have my vacant period at the end of the day, and not where it is now, because that would give me some time to go over to the gym and to get things ready for the students when they come and so forth." He said, "Mr. Swan," said, "that's a good idea." He said, "but the schedule is made." He said, "now here's the schedule." And he was also a master at scheduling. And what he did was took a piece of cork bulletin board and made grids, schedule grids. Now you pay money for these kinds of schedules. Of course, they are computers now. But and then he put different color of construction paper for grade levels and for subject matters. And he said, "now here is the schedule. Here's the entire schedule." He said, "now don't move anything. Now, how would you work your schedule to get yourself free at the last period?" I said, "oh, I would move this class from Miss Barber here, and this one here from Miss Jones, and this one here and here, and then that would free me over here." He said, "yes, Mr. Swan, but when you move that, what you did, you created a problem over here, because then there's a class that's unscheduled. Now, who's going to take that class?" And so I went through this. He let me go through this exercise.
To figure out. And, don't mess with that. Yeah,
and then at the end, I said, "I see what you're talking about." He said, "now, next year," he said, "you come in when we get ready to formulate the schedule, and we may be able to work that out." He said, "but now the schedule is set." One other thing he would do, you would come in with an idea. And he was very big on ideas, and you would share it with him. And he'd say, "Mr. Swan," he said, I've never heard him say that's a bad idea. He said, "you know, that has merit." He said, "now, take that idea and go back and set that down on some paper and then bring it back." And you'd go back and you start writing and you get halfway through it and you'd laugh. He said, "this is the craziest thing I ever thought about." And he would make you rethink things. And he was just that kind of person.
And that's an interesting, somewhat different perspective on the man that we get from just reading, and particularly from students who are just in awe of him, or in many ways terrified of him.
Yeah, they were really. I was on the end of the hallway, and there were mostly female teachers down in that area. And one day, one of the teachers called me, sent a student in to come and get me. Said, "come quick." So I went to the room, and the teacher was having an altercation with the student. And so I came to the student and I said, "look," I knew her, I said, let's leave. And so we are walking toward the door, and this teacher comes behind us, you know, berating the student. And the girl turned around and lunged for the teacher. So I pulled her back. And of course, with a young lady, she was about an eighth or ninth grader, and there are very few places that you can touch, you know. So I grabbed her wrist and went down the hall. When we got out in the hall, she was all right, but she, and the teacher followed us down to the office. So when I got to the office, I said, "Mrs. X, will you go back to the classroom? I'm going to take her into the office." So we got into the ante office there. And Mr. Peeler heard this fuss, and he came out. He said, "What's going on, Mr. Swan?" And I said, "This young lady's just had a problem with Mrs. Reynolds." And he said, he looked at her. He said, "You sit down and don't you move." She went. And then he said, "Mr. Swan, come in the office for a moment, please." And he said, "Look at you." Well, my shirt tail was out, and my tie was all around here, and I was disheveled, you know. And he said, "Now, is that worth it?" He said, "Next time she calls you to come down to her class, take your time going down there." You know, he said, "Take your time going down there." In other words, let her handle her own problems.
I want to come back later and talk about some of the legendary discipline of particularly male teachers at Price that we've heard about. But we just back up. Oh, go ahead.
Do you and then in 93, which was the first year of the merger, I was asked to be deputy superintendent by the new superintendent. I had planned to retire. My plans was to retire before I got 60, and I was planning to retire.
So much for that.
that next year, and once the superintendent was named, he went back to South Dakota, and I got a call the next day, and he said, "I've been checking on you," and I said, "Oh." He said, "I hear that you're going to retire after this year." I said, "Well, those are my plans." He said, "I want to make you an offer you can't refuse." And I said, "Okay, make the offer." You know, he said, "Well, I want you to stay on as deputy superintendent and put down everything you'd like to see in your contract." And I said, "Okay." I said, "Let me see your contract, because I plan to retire." And I said, "I know that if I'm going to stay longer than I plan to stay, I know I can't get the things that you get in the contract, but I can get close." So he laughed and made the contract available. So I sat down and I talked with some friends that I knew that were in administration and so forth, and I put down what I wanted. And he came to Greensboro the next week. I picked him up at the airport down in Raleigh, and he said, "Have you put that information together?" I said, "Yes, here it is." And he read it and said, "Okay, good, I'll take it to the board." And so I stayed on four more years, to make a long story short. I stayed on four more years as deputy superintendent. This was the first deputy superintendent that we had had in the system. I think Guilford County had a deputy at one time.
And then somewhere in here, were you also serving on the board?
How's that?
And the school board?
Well, what happened, I never served on the school board twice in between the superintendents. I served as the chair of the administrative team. In other words, between the last superintendent and this superintendent here, we had an administrative team. My responsibility was to work with the school board. One of the other assistant superintendents was responsible for state relations with the Department of Public Instruction. And the other one had another responsibility, and they reported to me, and we just formed an administrative team, and I chaired that team. I did that twice, I believe, during...
Maybe that's what I was thinking. Of course, obviously, you couldn't serve on the school board and be a...
Yeah, no, I couldn't serve on the school board. I served on the board at A&T for a term, yeah. Mm-hmm.
How, over the time, do you think the school... administration of schools, both at the school level and at the district level, did it become integrated, relatively racially integrated? Or did you find yourself rather exceptional as an African American working in that such a high level in this district administration?
You're talking of black administrators.
Mm-hmm.
Uh, during that period of time, in my early years as an assistant superintendent, we had one minority assistant superintendent. That was Fred Cundiff. He was assistant superintendent for administration. And that year, it was back in 1975, Julius Fulmore was made an assistant, and he had taught at Price School also. He was made an assistant. But by that time, he was principal of Hampton School. Mm-hmm. He was made an assistant superintendent for elementary schools. I was made an assistant superintendent for pupil personnel services. Another minority was made director of federal programs. There were about three or four, and there was an effort during that time to make a definite shift in visibility for minorities in that area. And the same thing was happening throughout the state. Charlotte, Wake County, even Burlington. And of course, there was no organization per se, but we knew every minority superintendent in the county. We'd go to the meetings and we'd get to know who was where and so forth. Not all districts did that at that time, but most of your major districts, mm-hmm. Charlotte, Durham, Raleigh, Greensboro, Wake County, did that.
Yeah. Would you say were former Price teachers atypically successful in becoming administrators? I mean, with yourself,
yes,
and one other?
Julius Fulmore became a principal. He became a assistant superintendent. Spencer Gwynn, who was a social studies teacher, a good friend of mine, he became an assistant principal at Grimsley, and then later a principal at Lincoln Junior High, and then a principal at Peck Elementary School. My assistant principal, Wiley Yours, became an elementary principal. So, yes, they were able to move, and I think a lot of it was because of the Price experience. They were able to move into those areas.
Mm-hmm. I want to jump back to the beginning of your experience at Price in the 1960s, mm-hmm. but just to finish the tail end of it, mm-hmm. Do you recall when you learned that Price would close for good and what you thought about it? You know, this is after it's become an elementary school, but it stays as a magnet school, as a magnet elementary for
right.
a while. But when you heard that Price was going to close for good, what did you think?
Well, I thought that, first of all, I thought it could be utilized, you know, could still be utilized. And but that was not in the plans. But shortly after that, see what happens when a property like a school is no longer used for that purpose, it reverts back to the county, and the county had control of that facility. And shortly after that, I'm not sure whether it was a year or two, or it wasn't more than that, that it became the property of GTCC, mm-hmm. and they utilized that building for training purposes. Mm-hmm. So it was still being used, and it still was called the J.C. Price building and or facility at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But you didn't think... were you sad to see the school close, obviously?
I thought at some point that it may be brought back online. I thought at some point, and I was hoping that possibly would occur.
Mm-hmm. I want to go back to the beginning of your entree into Price. What attracted you about J.C. Price? Why did you want to come there from where you had been in Hereford County?
Well, to be purely honest with you, I needed a job.
Yeah. That's a good reason.
What happened was when I finished college, I got a commission as a second lieutenant in the Army. And I went, I had to serve a tour of duty. Once I served that tour of duty, when I came out, my parents had lived here in Greensboro. My father was a Methodist minister and a chaplain in the Army. When we lived all over the country, different places. And when prior to my getting out of the service, they lived here. By the time I got out of the service, they had moved to Durham. So I came to Durham after I got out of the service and started subbing in Guilford County, I mean in Durham County. Well, Mr. Peeler knew my parents. So I thought I wanted to go back to Baltimore. Baltimore was always sort of home base for my family. That was my father's home. And I was interested in YMCA work. And I was going back to Baltimore to go into the YMCA. Well, one summer when I was in college, I worked at the YMCA here and got to know the people there. Mm-hmm. So I came over one day to talk to Mr. Moorhead, who was the executive director of Hayes Taylor Y, about YMCA work and what I needed to do. Coming into Greensboro, I came down Benbow Road, and Mr. Peeler was in his yard working. So I just pulled in because I knew him and knew he was a friend of my family, and we started talking. And he said, "What are you doing now?" And I told him all the things that I'd been doing and what my plans were. And he said, "I'm going to do something. I'm going to send you an application, and I want you to fill it out and send it back to me as soon as possible." So I did my business here. I went back, and the next day or so, I got this application. I filled it out, sent it back to him. The next Saturday, I was out somewhere, and I came into the house, and my mother was in the living room talking to Mr. Peeler and his wife. On Saturdays, he taught audiovisual aids down at North Carolina Central, and that's why he was in Durham. Mm-hmm. And so when I came in, we spoke and everything, and he said, "Are you ready to go to work?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, I have an opening, and it's for a sixth grade teacher, and we had a teacher go out on maternity leave, and it's starting in January. And will you be available?" I said, "I'm subbing now." You know, I didn't even have a place to stay. I didn't know where Price School was. I knew Greensboro, part of it, because my parents had moved here while I was in college, and I would come back and forth, but I never liked Greensboro, be frank with you.
We'll erase that part.
Yeah, so I came over, didn't even have a place to stay at first. I commuted for a week till I found a place to stay. And so that's how I got to Price School, and the vacancy was in sixth grade. Well, when the sixth grade teachers found out I had a science background, they talked to Mr. Peeler and we made a deal. I taught all the sixth grade science, and they would take my class and teach whatever subject was appropriate at that time. And so that's what I did. And that's when I found out that elementary teachers, if there was any subject that they soft-pedaled, it was science, because most of them didn't like to teach it.
You think Principal Peeler had a hand in recruiting other teachers? Did he go out and grab the teachers wanted?
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He was very picky about the teachers that he would select, he was very good at getting people that fit in with the staff that he already had. He was almost like a coach that is looking for a certain kind of player to fit in with the players that he already has, and he was very keen at making that happen.
Mm-hmm. How much guidance or supervision did you have in what you taught or how you taught it? Did you follow a standard course of study?
We had a standard course of study, but you had some latitude for instance, I taught earth science, and I would, and life science, and sometimes I would have my class outside, and you know, we would do some things outside of the classroom building. It was my thought that you know, the building was just to facilitate, you know, the process, and you could have school anywhere.
Wherever you got students and a teacher, you got a school.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And so he gave you a lot of latitude in that, but you did have to pretty much stay within the parameters of the syllabus and what needed to be covered over a period of time and so forth.
And you're getting this from the district or from the state or both?
Well, the state has the state course of study, and within that course of study, for instance, my style of teaching, I like group work and peer learning, and that's what I did primarily. For instance, and another thing, every class that I taught had to have a live project, you know, whether it was a snake or whether
I wouldn't have liked you.
And one group did have a snake called Jake the Snake, and a hamster or whatever, and they had to take care of that and so forth. And we did mostly group work, and we even had students that had to prepare portions of the lesson and give that portion of the lesson to their classmates. So if you'd come in my class, if you were looking for students to be in rows and for them to be deathly quiet, you probably wouldn't like my class.
But Principal Peeler,
oh, he allowed
let
that
you
to happen. Oh yes, yes, mm-hmm. yes, yes.
Okay. Did you, when you were teaching at Price, did you live in Warnersville?
No, I did not. Mm-hmm. Well, there was one, I did not initially, and then I moved right on the edge of Warnersville. I found an apartment. I was living with a family at first in a room and for a couple of years, and then I found an apartment. Well, it was the second story of a house that the people made into an apartment. And that was right on the edge of Warnersville, but I went to church in Warnersville, which was St. Matthew's, which was located there in Warnersville, and I was very active in the community.
So you felt part of the community,
the parents,
right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did you notice, so being, you know, having come, not grown up there, but coming to be part of it, did you notice any difference in attitude that other Black communities elsewhere in Greensboro and or other students and teachers, say at Gillespie or Lincoln, had about Warnersville residents and had about J.C. Price students? I've heard from the students' perspective that they felt, because they weren't as well off as some of the other neighborhoods in Greensboro, that they got looked down on to a degree by other students or other, you know,
It's like Nazareth. It's like Nazareth. Nothing good can come out of Nazareth. I mean, that was the thinking of the students in terms of the perception that they thought others had of them. And that was one of the challenges that we had as teachers, is to try to change that perception, to let them know that you were just as smart, you're just as talented, you're just as gifted as any other students, no matter what school they attend or whatever part of the city or the community that they live in. And that was a challenge, yeah.
And I think it's, you know, talking to some former students that ended up becoming, you know, thanks to the work that you all did to instill that sense of self-reliance and pride,
right,
and even kind of wanting to show up those low expectations, that became a strength that carried
it
those
was
students
a strength.
Forward.
And Warnersville was the kind of community that before redevelopment, everybody knew each other, and if a youngster was doing something wrong and another parent saw him, they would correct that youngster right there and make call their parent, and the parent will get them when they get home. I've had many parents to tell me when I call them about something, they said, you take care of him there, and I'll take care of him when he gets home. Yeah. So we had the support of the parents. They were not by any means well off, but they had great values, and they wanted more for their children. And they supported the school in that effort. Mm-hmm.
So you think there was a real connection between the school and the community, parents in the school? What about teachers and well, Mr. Peeler out in the community?
Well, we were always in the community, because that community, it was the school, the church, and the community center. Those were the sort of institutions that kept Juanesville, you know, the glue that kept them together. See, the interesting thing, Juanesville went through sort of a metamorphosis. At one time, Juanesville was the community, was the black community. Ash Street was the street. The funeral homes were there. The churches were there. The store, some stores and entrepreneurs were there. The doctors were there. Dr. Mm-hmm. Hampton, who Hampton School, had his office there, and others. So at one time, Juanesville was, and Ash Street was the place. But over a period of time, people began to move in other sections of the city, and Juanesville sort of, deteriorated to a certain extent. Mm-hmm.
Though still in your time, would you call it meaning in the 1960s, mm-hmm. How would you describe the kind of cohesiveness of Warnersville as a community in terms of, you mentioned the community institutions, but do you recall the black businesses that were there? Mm-hmm.
Well, some of that was gone, but the churches and the school and the community center still held strong in that community.
I had heard from a couple of students nostalgically recalling the sweet shop.
Oh, yeah.
Being able to smell the smells and wafting over the campus.
And there's Tom's Take Home and a couple of others here. Gentleman, Mr. Black, who lived to be 100, had a store there in Warnersville. And it was a thriving community at one time.
Mm-hmm. And this would be even in your day.
I came in on the tail end of some of mm-hmm. that, yes.
You mentioned being very involved in the community and other teachers at Price, mm-hmm. like you were. How involved were Price teachers and or administrators in the during the movement years and the Black Freedom struggles in Greensboro during the 1960s?
Very much involved. Very much involved. Many of the teachers were a part of the sit downs or the sit ins and. They marched and did a lot of things. It was interesting. We were down on the square, and everybody, it was adults primarily, and everybody sat down in the middle of the square.
This had been Jackson Square in like the spring of 1963, those mass demonstrations.
This was on Elm and Market Street. Mm-hmm. In the middle of the street. And so I was sitting there, and a couple of Price people were there. And I can't think of who said it, but somebody said, you know what? Said, we can't go to jail. Said, Mr. Peeler and those kids are going to be waiting for us Monday. We got to get. So as the police encircled us, we just sort of got up and moved out, because we knew Mr. Peeler, regardless of what our intentions were mm-hmm. In terms of civil rights, we better be there for those kids Monday morning. so mm-hmm. we got it. But he was very supportive in those efforts. Mm-hmm. At the height of that, I was principal at the height of a lot of that. Mm-hmm. Too.
You're talking, I mean, you're there.
And Lewis Brandon was on the staff, and Lewis was very active in the community. Mm-hmm. In fact, I got a call from the superintendent's office, and they accused him of being out somewhere doing his civil rights things. And I said, no. I said, Mr. Brandon is in his classroom. And so what they said, well, what happened was he had loaned somebody his car, and his car had these speakers on it, and they thought that he was there, you know, but he was very true to his profession, and he was in his classroom. Mm-hmm. But Lewis was probably one of the most active ones of our staff in terms of the civil rights movement.
And did he pay a professional price for that? Did he eventually cost him his job? Or am I wrong about that?
I don't know. No, okay. I don't think so.
Okay. No. Well, I guess, but do you think, did Principal Peeler and then yourself getting pressure from the district administration, who were probably getting pressure from the city,
never got
to
real
have
pressure.
Your teachers?
The only time that it was in question is I'm not sure who called, but someone from central office called and wanted to know, was he there? Mm-hmm. You know, that they thought that he was out in the community with these speakers and whatnot. I said, no, he's not. He's in his classroom. I know he's in his classroom.
Were you conscious when you were, even before that, as a teacher, that Principal Peeler was getting pressure and or running interference? You know, when the movement is getting started and they're trying to pressure to keep teachers from being involved, do they try to use the leverage they had of you know, this being a public school, to try to get his teachers to stay
Peeler
out?
Peeler was more, he said, you know, on your own time. You know, when you're in school, you're here for a purpose to teach children, but on your own time, you know, you can be involved or whatever, at whatever level you feel that it's important. I don't ever remember him making any statements to the contrary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just
Now, evidence, he may have been under some pressure, but he
shielded you all from that.
Right, right.
So did you get the impression from him that he was supportive of the movement?
I think he was. Mr. Peeler was a very complex individual, and he was a stickler for rules and order and things of that nature. And his main concern was that school, and that school was able to run successfully, and that meant you take care of the kids. Mm-hmm. But I don't ever remember even thinking that he was under any pressure, because I don't think he would have allowed himself to be under pressure to do that. He was a man that had a way with words and a way of making others think about the situation, he was not what an Uncle Tom is. He wasn't an Uncle Tom. He was, now some may have thought that, but he had a way of getting what he wanted from the other side.
And so you yourself, you said you were active in the protests. Mm-hmm. You participated in them.
Yes.
And Price parents as well. I mean, is the Warnersville community
actively involved
in the? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What are some of your memories of Price School? You know, memories of the school, memories of teaching. Any, you've already shared some stories about mm-hmm. adventures in the hallways, but or in the front office. But you have other memories of the school?
Well, I guess my memories involve just the relationship that I had as a teacher with other teachers, the relationship even when I became principal of the school, and it was probably rare to be promoted from within. And I think Mr. Peeler had a great deal to do with that, with my succeeding him as principal. I think my fondest memories is that the teachers, even though most of them were, see, I was 30, 31, and most of the teachers were, a lot of them were my parents' age. And they accepted me and respected me for the position that I held, and that was very gratifying. I think the main thing about Price School were the students and the relationship we had with the students. I still see many of those students today, and they come up to me and talk about the old times, and I kid them when I introduce them to someone or I see them. I just tell them that we were in school together. And many of those students have risen to really outstanding positions. And for instance, Janice Gilliard, Janice Brewington now, is the provost at North Carolina A&T State University. Another young lady, Barbara Watson, is a professor, a doctor in the area of psychology. Just so many have done a lot of good things in the community and working in important jobs all over the city.
Would you credit some of the education they got at Price?
Oh, surely. And they do. They do. That's where they got their basics from, and they'll tell you that. And they're proud of it, too.
Seems like from you hear from students, the education at Price is very broadly defined. I mean, in addition to your teaching them science, what else were you teaching students?
Manners, decorum, things of that nature. Just how to be a successful person in your life. For instance, I had a young lady. She was in my homeroom, and in the morning, you better not cross her in the morning, because she was just on edge. During the day, she would leave homeroom. She would come back to me for another class, a science class. Midday, she was fine, just happy-go-lucky and everything. Come back at homeroom time, at the end of the day, and she was all puffed up again. And I said, something is not right here. So I went to her home to visit early one morning. And I saw what the problem was. There were 6 or 7 of them in one of the apartments there. One bathroom, one kitchen, 2 bedrooms. And she had to, and I use fight as a broad term, to fight for space in the bathroom and to fight to get her breakfast, and by the time she got out of the house, she was just fired up, and that came to school. During the course of the day, she settled in and was doing all right. Then she got ready to go back to war, and these are the kind of things that the teachers took seriously and looked at each individual child and tried to respond to their needs,
I don't suppose there's much you could do about that.
No, wasn't much you could do. But what I would do in the morning is I'd sit and talk with her, a little bit. Ask how did it go this morning, and let her walk through some of these things, mm-hmm. And tell her that she needed to perhaps help her younger brothers and sisters get ready and help them do some things and just talk through some of the things, because this was the kind of thing that she'd never talked to her parents about.
I think that certainly speaks volumes, I would say, in the regard to which these students held their teachers, particularly we're talking about teenagers,
and
they respect you enough and trust you enough to.
Yeah, then I referred her to the guidance counselor, and told her about the situation, and she worked with her also, And each time we would see something in a student, one way or the other, we would try to intervene and to work. Even if a student showed promise in a certain area, we would try to give him or her more opportunities to shine and to do more things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you have such a breadth of experience in the schools. Is that, you think that kind of personal connection student to teacher has been lost? Or was there something unique about Price and in that time?
In a long time, but I would suspect some of it has been. Some of it has been. I'm not too sure that the staffs of today are as close as perhaps we were at that time.
And you think as part of that the community that you were part of the community.
That's right.
The school was the community. The community was the school.
Was part of the school. That's true.
You remember many of the extracurricular activities at Price? You certainly were very involved in sports. You have memories of the athletic teams, academic competitions.
We had a band, a junior high school band. We had the cheerleaders. We had the majorettes. We had clubs. We had a photography club. Mr. Peeler was an excellent photographer, and that was one of his hobbies. In fact, he taught me how to develop pictures and to take pictures. And there was a photography club. There was a radio club where students learned how to utilize the FM radio and so forth. We had an announcers group where kids would come to the office and make announcements over the PA and so forth. There were a lot of club, literary club with the librarian, student assistants in the office, in the guidance counselor's office, and library assistants and things of that nature. So all of the things that you had in any other schools, we tried to provide for those youngsters, and we had all of the here's something Mr. Peeler did. We did not have a football team in the black junior high schools, the two, Lincoln and Price. I don't know if Mendenhall was in existence then, but the other junior high schools, Kaiser and so forth, all of them had football teams. So Mr. Peeler went down to the superintendent and said, I would like to develop a developmental football program. He said, we need for you to provide us with the equipment and the pads and so forth, and we will just develop a developmental program. We won't play anybody. We'll just develop the skills. And we did that. And when we needed a scrimmage or whatever, Lincoln would come over, or we would go to Lincoln. But we didn't play any of the other junior high schools. And then Mr. Peeler went back. He said, now that we have a developmental program, and these youngsters have learned the skills of the game and the rules, we need competition. And that was the beginning of the integration of the junior high football team, where we played Kaiser and we played Mendenhall and we played Jackson and played all these other schools.
Huh. And this precedes, obviously, broader integration of the schools, or even integration of athletics, right? At the high school
correct.
Level.
That is correct.
Peeler got this.
Yeah.
Got his foot in the door.
Yeah, that's the kind of guy he was. He was very sharp, very crafty, and. Excellent man.
Hmm. You remember, you mentioned the band. You're going to talk a little bit more about some of your members of the band. Mm-hmm. That's certainly a highlight when we've talked to other people.
The band was really the highlight when we got band uniforms and so forth, and had a band director, and we had one of the best junior high school bands around and had a lot of students involved in it. We had a dance group, had a choral group, all of those kinds of things we had. Every outlet that we thought that was needed for the youngsters' growth and development, we provided for them. Mm-hmm.
I guess, and that kind of answers the next question is, what was the, you know, from the teacher's perspective, mm-hmm. what was the point of all these activities?
To exposure. You know, a lot of the youngsters did not have those opportunities. And parents, in some instances, couldn't provide those opportunities. So the school went beyond, you know, reading, writing, and arithmetic to expose youngsters to other kinds of opportunities. And we felt that that was a part of their education, of being a rounded person. Mm-hmm. And for us, it was natural. You know, it wasn't anything over and beyond. In some other school, it may consider it, but for us, it was natural.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember I've seen a picture of the PTA pageant. Do you recall that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What was that?
I'm not sure when that took place, but...
Or if it was an annual thing, it wasn't just the one time.
Yes, and they would name a queen or I forgot what they would call the person.
It seemed like the picture looked like a grand event.
Yeah, it was.
Do you remember the school code?
Yes, I do. I got a copy of it here.
You still carry it with you?
Yeah, I got a copy of it.
I noticed it's because it spells out J.C. Price.
J.C. Price, yeah, uh-huh. Got that. We also, Shelton Williams, who was the band director, also wrote a school song.
Mm-hmm. You remember the song?
Yeah.
How about a few bars?
I've got that too.
Yeah? Do you remember the tune? We've only seen it written down.
From school to you, the strength and sin. We love you tenderly, I think is where it goes.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we'll get people to sing it.
Yeah, we will. Yeah. But I've got the words there.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
And when we had the reunion, we sang it, and he played it on the saxophone. He that was his instrument.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Williams did.
Yeah, Shelton Williams.
Right, because he had gone on then to be director right at Dudley and then
A&T.
Yeah,
right. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we're actually interviewing him, so we can mm-hmm. certainly have to talk to him more mm-hmm. about that.
He'll play it for you.
Okay, I'll have to make sure they have him do that. Do you recall the disciplinary standards and disciplinary methods at Price? We've heard some from Mr. Gwynn has told us some about them, and some of the students who are on the receiving end have told about them. What about you yourself? Did you have particular techniques otherwise?
We did a little paddling during that time. It was interesting that it wasn't malicious. In other words, a lot of times we give a youngster an alternative, you know. Well, you get two licks or you're going to have to stay and do such and such such a thing, you know, clean the blackboards or whatever, whatever, whatever. And a lot of them say, well, Mr. Swan, I'll take two or whatever. Now, another thing, one thing that I did, it was a little unorthodox, and word got around. I came in the room, and I was out in the hall, and I came in the room, and these two guys were fighting, going at it. So I took them, and I asked Ms. Barber, the media specialist, to look in on my class. I gave them an assignment, and I took them over to the gym. In the gym, there is a room where the mats are kept, and the wrestling team would practice in there sometime. The room was very warm because it was near the boiler, and sometimes they would practice in there so that they could sweat and get their weights, you know. So, and the room was like a padded room. The mats were on all walls, and it was mats on the floor. And I took these two young men over. I mean, they were really going at it. And when we got over, I think it was in the wintertime, they had to put on their coats. So when they got over, I said, keep your coats on, your hats. I said, now, you guys wanted to fight, and you were going at it just tooth and nail. I said, okay, go on and fight. And they looked at me. I said, fight. And they made some effort. I said, that's not fighting. I said, now, you guys are about to knock things over in the classroom. You disrupted everything. And you come over here and you're making love to each other. You're not fighting. Well, Mr. Swan, we're not mad anymore. I said, but you were mad over there. I said, now, I'm going to tell you something. You didn't fight. And we're going back to the classroom. And if I hear anything else about this, I'm going to tell the class that you came over and made love to each other instead of fighting. You wouldn't do that, Mr. Swan. I said, yes, I would. Now, when they asked you what happened, you say it's a private matter and leave it alone. You understand? Yes, sir. So we went over, and it was interesting. They'd be saying, it's a private matter. It's a private matter. And never had any problem out of them again.
So you used a psychological technique.
Never had any problem.
Yeah. But you swung the occasional paddle.
Yeah, occasional, and we would keep youngsters after school, and then I'd take them home. You know.
So you took them. So their parents would
see
you
delivering. Yeah, I'd take them home, put them in the car, take them home.
And what was the reception like when you dropped them off on the front porch?
Thank you for bringing him. I'll take care of him, Mr. Swan.
You didn't have to worry after that.
Right. We had. I remember once I was principal at this time, and there's always a student that's going to tell you everything. And this young man, he stuttered, and he came, and he said, Mr. Swan said, and he named the students. He said, they left campus. I said, left campus? He said, they're going to the store to buy their lunch. I said, which way did they go? He said, and he showed me where. So there was a incline. The school sat on a hill and the street was down here. So sure enough, I looked out the window and I saw them coming back with their bags and stuff, you know. So as they came up the walkway, I peered out of the building. And I said, come on, let's go to the office. And I said, put your food up there. I said, now, you know better than leaving. And the thing about it was some of our better students, some of our student council people, some of our better students. And I said, what gives here? They said, we are supporting the cafeteria strike. I said, that's very admirable of you to support the cafeteria strike. But when you support an effort like this, it must be sacrifice. Now, you could have made the decision not to eat lunch at all, but you broke a rule. You left school to go and eat lunch. I said, I am going to call all of your parents. Don't call up. I said, yes, I'm going to call your parents and tell them what happened. And I called each one's parents, and I said, they bought this food. They said, Mr. Swan, give that food away. Don't give it to them. And so they had the food. And they said, well, we got ice cream in it, it didn't melt. I said, so be it. I said, now, lunch or buy your lunch like you had planned, or you go to the cafeteria and don't eat lunch. I said, you can support the strike. And this was my student council president. I said, that's great. That's great. Support them. But you're going to have to sacrifice to do it. And so they learned the lesson. We had nobody else leaving school after that.
And were the students supportive of the strike?
How's that?
The students were supportive of the strike?
Yes, they were supportive of the strike, of the cafeteria workers. And I said, one way you could have supported the strike is to go down and sit at the table, be quiet, but don't eat. Don't buy anything. Or bring your own lunch. Bring your lunch from home. Yeah. So.
You'd been at a sit-in. You knew what real protest was.
Well, each we tried to take each incident, whether it was negative or positive, and make something positive out of it. You know, a lesson out of it. You know, to let them know that there's a right way of doing things. There's a wrong way of doing things. You can support certain things without breaking the law. You know. That's what we tried to do.
Any other recollections or memories of your time at Price?
There's so many. One of the things that we tried to do is to let the students see us as people. For instance, we would have talent show contests or shout talent shows. And the faculty would participate. You know, they'd sing the songs. In fact, we even had a faculty band. I played the drums. Shelton played the saxophone. We had another teacher to play the bass. And we had about six or seven of us. And they just went wild. They just thought it was the greatest thing in the world, you know, that we were trying to play these instruments. So that was, you know, one remembrance that I have. Mm-hmm.
So that sort of family connection between
yes.
the students
mm-hmm.
and the
mm-hmm. yeah.
Was it? I was wondering if it was difficult for Mr. Shelton to, or Mr. Williams to have you amateurs playing
yeah,
along
he,
with him.
He helped us a lot. We had practice. We got through it.
And what about what are your memories of when Mr. Peeler retired? You know, we've read some of the letters that students were writing him, you know, very warm letters and respectful letters, but you could sort of sense in there some anxiety about what was next, and of course, doubly for you, because you're about to take over for him. Do you remember what that process was like, knowing not only is he leaving, but you're having to step into his shoes?
Well, you don't step into Mr. Peeler's shoes. I mean, he cast a long shadow, but I think that, see, I was his assistant principal for 2 years, 3 years actually, before that. And 1 year I was on leave because I was given a grant to work on my degree, and I was back and forth to the school, but actually 3 years as assistant principal. And I learned a lot from him. And really, when the time came, I didn't feel like I knew all the answers, but I felt that I was ready because he prepared me. He endorsed me, and that endorsement meant a lot to, I'm sure, the administration, and it meant a lot to the faculty and staff of the school. And it was almost a seamless changeover with him. And they had a reception for him, and at that reception they had me and my wife and he and his wife in the receiving line, and it was sort of like a change of the guard, so to speak. And mm-hmm. One thing that he never did, and I invited him many times and asked him. One time he came over at the end of the school day, and I had the window up at my office, and he talked to me through the window. He never did come back, never set foot in that school while I was there as principal.
Why, you think?
I think he felt that it was my time, and that he was a monument or something that would have a brief history of that school where people from years to come could see what happened here was significant.
On the site.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What about...
And not just you know, you've seen those markers on the highway thing, not just something like that, something much more than that.
Mm-hmm.
We hadn't talked about what specifically. We just knew that we wanted the school to be remembered, you know, in some significant way. That's the way we put it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and we were open to ideas and so forth.
Yeah. Well, I hope, you know, that's one of the motives of this mm-hmm. project is that we can, you know, begin the collection of that kind of material
right.
that
right.
can then build, can perhaps turn into an exhibit at the Historical Museum
okay.
or, you know,
right.
Some permanent and resources that future researchers can use.
Right.
Anything else to add? You want to
no, that's okay. about it that I have here.
Okay.